Welcome to the Cloud Marathon and thank you for attending this session going to Azure SQL, admin difference no one told you before. We will focus on how to manage Azure SQL and the difference that this managing process has in relation to on-premise SQL. My name is Dennis Torres. I'm a data platform MVP. I'm a trainer with some Microsoft certifications, and I'm the Malta Data Platform User Group leader. You can see here on the right side my contacts. Feel free to get in touch. It will be a pleasure to get in touch and ask me anything. Our agenda today will focus a lot on auditing and monitoring. See information about custom monitoring agents, extended events, manage identities with extended events, and we end up talking about automation. This is the agenda for this session. Let's start with auditing and monitoring. Auditing and monitoring on Azure SQL. How can we do that? We have two limitations that are considerable limitations. First, SQL Profiler that most people use don't work on Azure SQL. And we don't have direct access to the storage of the machine. We don't have direct access to the machine itself. So, how do we manage auditing and monitoring? We use a service called Log Analytics. Log Analytics is an essential service on Azure. I'm not talking for Azure SQL. I'm talking on Azure. Log Analytics is an essential service on Azure. Using Log Analytics, we can make our migration to the cloud way easier. I consider, in my opinion, there is a set of services that we need to configure and plan from the very beginning when we plan to go to the cloud. From the very beginning, we need to configure the services and plan how we will use this service. And one of these services is Log Analytics. We need to use Log Analytics correctly, and it gives a huge help to Azure SQL. Log Analytics is part of Azure Monitor, so it's part of a bigger service which is called Azure Monitor. And Log Analytics use custom language. Yes, that's what I'm talking. I'm saying that to manage a database in the cloud, an Azure SQL in the cloud, you need to learn a new language, a new data language, that's custom language. Log Analytics use dashboards and workbooks. Log Analytics is a big container for logs, not only for the Azure SQL, but for many services on Azure. Any services on Azure can redirect its own logs to a Log Analytics workspace, how we call it. Then we can query this repository using custom language. We can make the queries using custom, or we can create dashboards and workbooks to visualize the information in a easier way. In fact, we can do both. We will start using custom. Then, when we notice we are using custom language very often, we are making the same queries very often, we end up creating a dashboard and a workbook inside Log Analytics. In relation to SQL Server, Log Analytics is related to two configurations. First, auditing of Azure SQL. The auditing can be enabled or disabled on a server level and on a database level. On the server level, the auditing will control the database settings for all database contained inside the server. And we can enable auditing on database level for Azure SQL as well. So you are seeing the image of the Azure SQL auditing screen configuration. This is for a database, and it's advising that the server level auditing is disabled. And besides auditing, on each database, we still configure what is called diagnostic set. In fact, this is a common configuration for most Azure objects. On most Azure objects, you find an item on the menu called diagnostic set. And this allows you to collect logs from that set and send these logs to Log Analytics. So Log Analytics will store those logs. Take a look at the amount of information that SQL Server can deliver to Log Analytics. SQL Insights, Automatic Returning, Query Store Information. The Azure SQL will send weight statistics in two different levels. The Query Store Information collected, the information collected by Query Store, and the database weight statistics. Two different levels will be sent to Log Analytics. Timeouts, blocks, deadlocks, basic information, and so on. All this information will be sent to Log Analytics. Let's see a demonstration about how we do this, how do we configure this. Here I'm on the Azure portal. I already created a resource group for the Cloud Marathon, and I already created some objects. I did the beginning of the work. So, Cloud Marathon, and I already created some objects. Among the objects that I already created here are a SQL database and the server for this database. So, this is already created inside the resource group called Cloud Marathon. But the diagnostics is not configured. And to configure the diagnostics and send the diagnostics information to a Log Analytics, I need to create a Log Analytics workspace. Let's do that. So I want from the marketplace a Log Analytics workspace. Create. It asks me what resource group it will use, in what resource group it will be created, Cloud Marathon, the name of the workspace, let's call Cloud Diagnostics, and the region that will be used, North Europe. So let's choose North Europe, then price entire, the default page that you go, tags, review and create. So as you are seeing, the creation of a Log Analytics workspace is something very easy. Our Log Analytics is deployed. Let's go back to home. Clone Marathon. I can already see the Log Analytics workspace. So let's configure the Azure SQL. I first configure on the server level. Let's go to the server level. And on the server level, we have the audit configuration on server level. So I can enable audit configuration and decide to where I will send the audit information. I have three options. Azure is flexible. It gives me three options. I can send the audit information to a storage, to Event Hub, or to Log Analytics. If I send to storage, the log will be there, in storage. We can be creative and imagine ways to read this log. Synapse Analytics, for example, to read big data would be a solution to read this log. But it would not be that easy as Log Analytics, not compared with Log Analytics. Event Hub, it's for streaming. The data will not be on Event Hub. Event Hub will create rules to analyze this data in asset with string analytics, Azure string analytics, and deliver the data to somewhere. So it's a second option, but the data will not be stored. Although Event Hub can then send the data to a storage. The data will end up in a storage. And finally, we can send the data to Log Analytics. Log Analytics will store the data for us and we will be able to query this data using Coastal language. What subscription is my Log Analytics? It events allow me to send the information to a different subscription if I would like. More than that, Azure has features to even allow control between different companies, between different tenants. Imagine that one company that don't know too much about how to manage Azure wants to hire another company to make this monitoring. It's possible to configure Azure SQL to send the logs to a Log Analytics in another tenant by using a feature called Azure Lighthouse. I will not get in details about Lighthouse. Another thing, another subject. But it exists and allows this kind of partnership. One company using Azure hires a partner to manage their Azure environment, and a connection between the partner environment and the company Azure environment is made by Lighthouse. So I choose my Log Analytics environment. I choose Cloud Diagnostics that I just created. For a special support operation, when the company asks the support of Microsoft, I can choose if I will log these operations or not, and if you log to the same destination or not. But this is a very specific situation. So I'm enable the auditing on the server level. It's saving the operation. Saved. The operation is saved. Audit is enabled on the server level. I can check the database level. This that you are seeing here is a small UI bug. It's a bug because I already saved the audit configuration, but it doesn't identify that I already saved and ask me again. Oh, you lose unsaved information. I already saved it. I just saved it. Okay, to continue. AdventureWorks LT. Now I'm seeing my database. On the audit configuration, I'll be able to see that auditing is already enabled on a server level. I can also enable auditing on a database level if I would like. Some additional message will be sent to Log Analytics if I enable on database level as well. I'm enabling auditing on a database level, save, and it's done. Now, with this configuration, we configure auditing for the database and for the server. This already creates something different on our environment. Let's get back to our resource group. Here, let's make a refresh. And we have a new item here. We have a guy called SQL Auditing. And what is SQL Auditing? Is a solution. What's a solution? On the context of Log Analytics, a solution is a set of dashboards pre-built to show to us a point of view of some information. So this is a pre-built solution to show to us one point of view. And this solution is focused on SQL auditing. So when we enable the SQL auditing on the server and on the database, Now the team solution was created, linked to our log analytics workspace. The log analytics workspace is here. The log data is contained inside log analytics workspace. But the auditing solution will show this data to us in a better format. Let's take a look what this solution can show to us, although it doesn't have too much data at this moment. Let's click View Summary. Sometimes things are a bit hidden, so I had to click View Summary to find the information that this solution has to show to us. And I can see the information security insights, but at the moment there are no security insights because we just created the configuration and the solution. But I have many information here about logins, about the access to our SQL Server. Security information are centralized on this solution, are being displayed on this solution. The information itself is inside the Log Analytics workspace, but is being displayed here. So getting back, view summary again, and it's showing the two kinds of information that are being collected, which are security insights and SQL access to sensitive data. Microsoft is very concerned about security of the data inside the companies and inside enterprise environments. So this solution showed to us access to sensitive data. What's a sensitive data? We can catalog the data and specify on our schemas inside the database what fields are sensitive data. For example, credit card number is a sensitive data. Email may be considered a sensitive data. Phone number are sensitive data. Then you can analyze who made access to this sensitive data and how often this access was done, the access to sensitive data was done. And this we are talking about the auditing solution. So we configured auditing. Let's configure the diagnostics as well. To configure the diagnostics, we go to the SQL database. On the SQL database, we make the diagnostics configuration here, diagnostics settings. Mind that there is already one diagnostics settings because the audit configuration, in fact, is a better way over the work of the diagnostics settings that is underneath this configuration. So we already have one diagnostics settings made for the audit information, sending the audit information to the log analytics workspace. Now I can add a new diagnostic settings and select all the information I would like to collect. I select everything. I want to collect all the available information here on this Azure SQL. And I can also define the collection of metrics on my Azure SQL as well. And again, I have the three basic options when defining diagnostic settings. Where would I like to send this information? Would I like to send to Log Analytics? Would I like to send to Azure Storage? Or would I like to send to Event Hub? I can choose. I can choose one of them. And of course, I choose Log Analytics and choose our Cloud Diagnostics workspace. Each diagnostic settings inside an Azure session needs a name. I need to create a name to this setting. Let's call Clouds Diag and save. It's updated. So I can return to my SQL database and the second diagnostic setting is already there. On this demonstration, we saw how to configure the auditing on SQL Server and SQL Database, and how to configure the diagnostic settings on SQL Database, how to send information to Log Analytics. We also saw how automatically the configuration of the auditing created an auditing solution showing to us all the information collected to the Log Analytics workspace. Moving forward, let's talk about Gusto. What's Gusto? Gusto is a new query language used by Log Analytics. So to query the information that is inside Log Analytics, we use Gusto language. It appears with SQL. It may be kind of similar with SQL, but it's not SQL. It's a new language that us as cloud DBAs need to learn. We need to master the Gusto language to manage the logs of our database servers on the web. Check this example of this query, Azure Diagnostics and Distinct Category. Azure Diagnostics is one table. The Log Analytics workspace can have many tables, and the existence of these tables are dynamic because many services can be sending information to the same Log Analytics workspace, and each service can create their own tables inside the Log Analytics workspace. So the existence of these tables are dynamic, and one of the main tables is Azure Diagnostics. Azure Diagnostics receives information from many servers, not only SQL. Many servers decide to, instead of creating their own tables, they just send the logs to Azure Diagnostics. They just insert the information inside Azure Diagnostics. So it's one of the most common tables that we will use inside the Log Analytics workspace. Monitoring. We use custom queries to access the data. So when we need to know something about our servers, we use custom language to retrieve the information from the environment. We can create and customize workbooks to visualize the information in an easier way. But we also have one solution called SQL Analytics. We can use this SQL Analytics solution to help us access the information in Log Analytics. In the same way, the audit solution that was automatically created help us to visualize audit information from Log Analytics, the SQL Analytics solution will help us to see information about SQL from inside the Log Analytics workspace. It doesn't mean this is something complete. It's a helper, but it will not prevent you to make custom queries and create your own workbooks. And what's most important, one very good benefit that we get from this scenario, it's great to create a baseline for the service. Everyone always tell, oh, we need to have a server baseline. We need to have a baseline for our servers to manage our servers. But how easy is it to create a baseline for our servers? To know exactly how our servers behave on every week, on every day of the week, on every hour of every day of the week. How our servers behave on these scenarios is difficult. But once we are collecting the information from our Azure SQL and sending this information to a Log Analytics workspace, the creation of a baseline for our SQL servers are just one query away from us. One custo query away. We can master the custom query and use the custom queries to retrieve baseline information about the user behavior of our servers. So every time our servers get out of the user, we can receive some kind of alert about this. And this also works with virtual machines in on-premise environments. Yes, you don't need to migrate to the cloud first to start using Log Analytics. You can start using Log Analytics to monitor your servers even before migrating to the cloud. You can do that. And in fact, I consider that this option is a great feature to convince everyone in the company about the benefits of the cloud. All the challenges that you had before to build a baseline for your service will be gone. You will collect the information on Log Analytics and people will see the benefits of the cloud. So, we need to create, we have the Azure SQL Analytics, which is a solution in preview. It's marketed as preview on the marketplace. And we just create the solution and we link the solution with our Log Analytics workspace. We need to tell the solution from what workspace you read your data. You read your data from the workspace that we are using to store the data. And this allows us to create the Azure SQL Analytics solution. And this is a small view of the solution. We can see the information about our database, the metrics of CPU usage, query duration, waiting per waiting types, and so on. We have a lot of information that is already displayed in a good visual way on these solutions. It doesn't mean it's really complete, but it's already a very good start. Database weight stats, for example, another benefit of the solution, and many metrics about the database. CPU utilization, storage, data I/O, and so on. Many metrics about the database that we are collecting the information. Let's see a demonstration. Let's see how it works. First, I'll create a lot of activity on our database so we can better analyze the behavior of our database. To create this kind of activity, I use a tool called SQL Query Stress. This tool was created by Adam McKenicky and it helps a lot to create activity, random activity inside the database server. So let's go. What's the server? Let's get the information about the server on our Azure page, Cloud Marathon Database Windows.net. So the server Cloud Marathon Database Windows.net. I will enable SQL Server Authentication just to be easier. And the default database will be AdventureWorks Legal. Test connection. Okay, connection succeed. Now I'll create some window activity. Select staff from Sales LT customers. Let's add one more table to the script. And now let's make further configurations to the script execution. Number of interactions 100. Number of threads 10. In fact, the calls to the server will be multiplied. Number of interactions multiplied by number of threads. Each thread will make 100 interaction. So I'll hit go and it will take some time to execute everything. And it's done. It's done. The execution is done. Now we can check the logs and see how the activities are in the logs. First of all, let's go directly to the source. Let's go to our Log Analytics workspace. So inside the Log Analytics workspace, we have the option Logs. And when we choose the option Logs, it opens to us a query environment. And we can use queries about many cells that may be sending information to this Log Analytics workspace. But I will not use the templates. And we can see here that the workspace has the Azure Diagnostics table. Let's make a refresh, just be sure that is only this table that is here now. Azure Monitor table would appear at some moment, but sometimes there is a lag for the Azure SQL to really send the information to Log Analytics workspace. Now that we are inside the query environment of our workspace, let's start making some queries. I created some files here, demo files, and the first demo file, demo zero, it contains exclusively custom queries. So we have many custom queries here. Let's execute these custom queries on our Log Analytics workspace and let's analyze the syntax of these custom queries and how we can analyze the information contained inside our Log Analytics workspace. First and foremost, I can just use Azure Diagnosis, which is the name of the table, and I'll be asking to see everything on Azure Diagnosis, on Azure Diagnosis table. Everything? Really everything? No. The query environment of Log Analytics controls a time range. So we have a time range here. We can define a time range by the query environment, or we can define the time range in the query. So the time range from the query environment will be ignored. I'm not defining a time range on the query, so I will get the time range from the environment. It's showing me the last 24 hours. And these are the logs, Log Analytics history on the last 24 hours. Remember, I just created this workspace, so everything here is coming from SQL. So I have many information about the events and I need to decipher everything. How this needs to be deciphered. Let's start with the category column. What are the available categories inside this table, Azure Diagnostics? What categories can we query? So, Azure Diagnostics. Take a look how I use a pipe to continue a custom query on the following lines. I need to use a pipe on the following lines. I start with the table and use a pipe to add new members to the query and to see the category values inside the category column, just use distinct category. So it will show to me all the categories available on the environment. Until now, I have only the SQL security audit events. Sometimes I have some delay on the collection of the information. So for now, I have only the security audit events. Just to make sure that is just really a delay, nothing is wrong, I'll get back to my Azure SQL and be sure the diagnostics configuration is perfectly fine. So Cloud Marathon. I need to go to the database, diagnostic settings on the database, and the Cloud DR is here and ready to send all the information to the Log Analytics workspace, to the Cloud Diagnostics. So the configuration is correct. I mean, so one thing, the workload management, but so don't want to that I can include now, but soon, in some minutes, the other categories will be there in Log Analytics. So let's check again the categories. For now, I have only the SQL Security Audit events. So let's use this category. Let's make a query about this category. I'll copy the query that I have below, that was query information about query store, and the query about SQL Security Audit events. So, mind the way I included the where exactly with a pipe. So these are the SQL Security Audit events happening on SQL Server and be sent to the diagnostics. Great. I have some interesting columns that are resource, operation name, and actual name. Let's test these three items. One is resource, the other is operation name, and the last one, action name S. So resource, let's query and see the available resource. So resource, and I have the ADVWorks LT and master, these two resources. Let's select one of them, Azure Diagnostics, where resource equals ADVWorks LT. The equal is in fact two equals, we use two equals in custom. Run, and now I can see the log events, audit events. What happened with the resource? What has been recorded? Is recorded change on the audit session. In fact, when we have the configuration on the server level and the configuration on the database level, they keep synchronizing one to another all the time. They talk to each other and keep synchronizing with each other. That's very common. Actual name, audit session changed. Okay. We tested the resource field, let's test the others. And now I have the information. What I have in operation names? I have audit event, query store runtime statistics event, and error event. It's interesting, because we already seen query store runtime statistics event. Let's get back to our beginning, where we analyze the category, and we are seeing that now I don't have only security events anymore. Now I have query store runtime statistics and errors. So we can analyze query store runtime statistics as well. So I will query the information based on query store runtime statistics. Query store weight statistics is already available as a category. Let's double check the categories, because the information now is coming fast. See? I received more information already. Query store runtime statistics and query store weight statistics and database weight statistics. More information received from SQL Server. What can we do with this information? For example, query store weight statistics. I'll filter by this category and I can summarize the information. The quick store weight statistics can summarize and get details about the weight statistics on quick store. So I can note how the weight statistics are affecting my server. I can see that I have weight statistics related to memory, network I/O, and CPU. So I have these interesting weight statistics. Okay, but there is another category as well that is not related to query store and is related to weight statistics, is the database weight statistics. We have this option, database weight statistics. What's the relation between query store weight statistics and database weight statistics? Simple. The database weight statistics are the weight statistics that are happening in the database. The database is suffering by these weight statistics. They are happening in the database. While the query store weight statistics makes some work over this data. What query store does? Query store captures statistics for query execution, summarize the statistics according to some blocks of times configured in query store, and classifies the statistics. We don't see the real statistics, we see a classification. We are seeing that we have statistics related to memory, statistics related to network, but we don't know exactly what weight statistics was that. So, let's analyze the database weight statistics, which is a different way to analyze the information. So, we were checking the query store weight statistics. We can analyze the database weight statistics. Let's see what do we get. So we get information here on category database weight statistics. We get exactly what weight statistics is happening on the database. So, we can make, based on the database weight statistics, let's copy this query, I can use the summarize statement, and the summarize is specified by what weight type S. It's not complete because I need to specify what I use summarize. Let's choose some important values related to these statistics. Let's select the delta max weight time ms. This is a max, so let's summarize with a max expression. But we have the delta weight time ms, so I'll summarize this as sum the delta weight time msd. I was cutting the d on the name of the fields. Okay, so I'm summarizing by this, calculating these two fields by weight type s. Let's confirm I wrote everything correctly. Weight type S and exit. And now I know exactly the amount of time is being wasted with each kind of statistics. But how can I know how this related with time? Simple. I can make a summarize by two fields. And when it's related to time, the custo has the ability to make a bin I put the time generated, the time the information was generated, and define a bin of time. Let's say the bin is 1 minute. I don't have enough activity to make anything better than 1 minute. So I make bins of 1 minute. Sorry, I made a huge zoom here. Time generated. Run. And now I have the statistics classified by the execution on bins of 1 minute. And by the way, it's showing me only the 201. I don't have anything else. 1 minute is the information that the server has at the moment. But according the server receives more information, I'll be able to see additional information about the statistics. So this example is showing how the power that we have in our hands using custom queries and the log analytics workspace. We can use these queries, I can go way further on these queries, building a baseline for our servers. More than that, let's create new queries here. For example, I can get this query from database weight statistics. I copy it here. And I can choose to save this query. I will save this query as database weight statistics. Let's create a category called weight statistics. Save. So this query is saved. I can close. Let's get another one. Let's get the one I made for query store. So I will copy it here and save as query store weight statistics, and the category will be weight statistics. Save, and I have my second query saved. Where are these queries? I have a button here called Query Explorer, and I can check saved queries. I created the category weight statistics, and I have my two queries saved inside Log Analytics Workspace. So every time I return to the Log Analytics Workspace, I have these two queries available for me. I'll be able to use these two queries in the Log Analytics Workspace. That's great. Let's get back to the beginning. The Cloud Marathon resource group. And one feature that we haven't saw yet is the SQL Analyze solution. Let's go to the marketplace and select SQL Analyze SQL Analytics solution. Azure SQL Analytics. So I'm provisioning this solution, I create, and it immediately asks me from what Log Analytics workspace this solution will read the data. It will read the data from our Cloud Marathon. Where is it? Why it's not showing that I have it here? Okay, Cloud Diagnostics, I got confused with the name. Cloud Diagnostics, create, and now I have the SQL solution deployed. That's great. Here it is. Solution, SQL Analytics solution. View summary, and I can check the analytics information about my Azure SQL. Mind the amount of information that we have. Number of errors, total time of wait times, the amount of information that we have available related to this solution. You go down on the database level to see specific metrics on the database level, such as the wait types that are happening on the database level, network I/O, and shared yield were the biggest wait types on our database level. And we can also see the metrics about storage, details, and so on. So we have a lot of information available to monitor our Azure SQL and to create baselines, execution baselines to our Azure SQL. And all this using Log Analytics. Back to our slides. We completed the third demonstration. Let's talk more about monitoring agents and configuration. Monitoring agents can be saw as a consolation prize for the companies that are not in the cloud yet. So the consolation prize for services that are still running on-premise is that we can install Log Analytics agents. Log Analytics has agents for on-premise servers. We can install these agents on SQL Server on-premise, and it doesn't mind if they are running on Windows or even Linux. We can install those agents and capture information about the on-premise servers. These agents at the moment can only capture performance counters. It's the most important information they can capture. There are some other information we will talk about them. But in a close future, Arc Enable SQL Server is promising to capture more information from on-premise SQL servers, but this is not happening yet. For now, Arc Enable SQL Server is not expanding the data capture that the Log Analytics agents already do. We use the monitoring agents for that. On Log Analytics, we can download the agents and install these agents on on-premise machines. And we can configure these agents to collect information from the on-premise machines. There are many interesting information on this screen. First, the basics collecting Windows performance counters. If we want to monitor Azure SQL, we need to collect Windows performance counters. Unfortunately, we don't have all the data available to us. On Azure SQL, we can collect all those information that we saw. Wait stats, query store statistics, and so on. But on-premise, we can get is the Windows performance counters. Will this be always like this? No, this will not be always like this. This is set to be improved, and it's set to be improved very soon. Microsoft is creating a new set of features called ARC, Azure ARC Enable Servers, Azure ARC Data Services, and so on. What is Azure ARC? Azure ARC is exactly designed for hybrid environments to allow to manage environments that are outside Azure. And in many situations, Azure ARC is capable to get services that are on Azure. Imagine, Azure SQL is a service on Azure. You can get a service such as Azure SQL. Let's be precise. Azure ARC today works with managed instance, not Azure SQL or Azure SQL database itself, but it works with managed instance. You can get a service like managed instance which is a PaaS service, and using Azure Arc, you can install this service on AWS Cloud or on-premise. You can get the PaaS service from Microsoft and install in different environments using Azure Arc. So the potential for this is huge. What's the relation to this with what we are talking about? Simple. Microsoft already created Azure Arc enabled SQL servers. You can enable a SQL server on-premise to be managed by Azure using Azure Arc. However, all the management features that are provided now, in general, they are related to security. They are related to security and inventory, so you can manage what you have in relation to SQL on-premise. There is not an evolution yet in relation to the collection of monitoring data, but it will happen soon. So this is close to evolve. But at the moment, what we have? Windows Performance Counters that we will collect to manage our SQL Server. Windows Event Logs, yes, we can collect Windows Event Logs and send them to Log Analytics. So we will be able to manage way more than only Azure SQL, only SQL Server machines. We will manage the entire operational system. And you can collect Linux performance counters. Yes, it works with Linux. So we can collect Linux performance counters. More than that, we can collect IIS logs. This is not related to SQL, it's related to IIS. So we can collect information about IIS logs and retrieve graphics about how our IIS application is being accessed by the users. So we can build a dashboard about the access to our application, analyzing the IIS logs using Log Analytics. So it's quite powerful. It doesn't collect all the information that you would like yet about SQL Server, but it will get there soon. And a bit more about configuration, pricing tiers. It's interesting to note about the pricing tiers, the price of the ingestion of the data, but that's not what is important on this screen. What's important on this screen is to note the data retention. There is a data retention control on this screen. So you can control for how long Log Analytics will keep your data, and you also have a daily cap in case you need to control the amount that you paid by the collection of the log. Data retention, the default is 30 days. 30 days usually is not too much, not even enough to really collect a good baseline. So by default you need to customize this data retention, but this data retention can get up to 730 days. This is about 2 years. So Log Analytics can keep data about 2 years for your server. In most situations, this will be more than you will need. You will not need data for so long. So, these configuration options are important and you need to plan about them. The daily cap, as well as I mentioned, can control the amount of data you will collect every day, so you will not pass a specific amount of expenses by collecting the logs. Then, next stage. We're talking about log analytics that can keep the data for 2 years. Next stage, Azure Data Explorer. Let's say that the Azure Data Explorer is the big brother of log analytics, the older brother of log analytics. While log analytics is a ready-to-use solution, inside Azure Data Explorer is focused on the storage and the database area of this solution, allowing to customize dashboards as well and using custom language as well, but providing a very powerful environment to analyze data as logs and go beyond of the ability of log analytics. So a next stage is the Azure Data Explorer. Let's see a demonstration about this last configuration that we talked about. So here we have our Azure portal again, one more time. Let's go to our log analytics workspace, Cloud Diagnostics, and we talked about agents management. So we can download agents, install these agents on on-premise machines. How these agents will connect to the log analytics environment? These agents will connect using these keys, authentication keys that will be used for them to connect to the log analytics environment. And these agents can be used for Windows Server or for Linux servers. And we have the agent configuration where we can define what event logs we'll collect using these agents, performance counters we'll collect using these agents, and Linux performance counters will collect using this agent. Besides that, we can still collect IIS logs using this agent from web servers. If we have web servers, we can collect IIS logs from these web servers using these agents. So we can use these agents to collect information from on-premise machines. And usage and estimated costs. Here we saw the price in tiers, and here we have the option about data retention that I mentioned. This option can go starts in 30 days and can go up to 730 days, 2 years. 30 days is too low to most tasks that we'll be doing with log analytics. By 2 years, sometimes is way more than we need. And as I explained it, we also have the daily cap. If we need to control the amount of logs collected daily, we can establish a daily cap and will not pass this volume of logs collected every day. Let's make a small summary about what we talked about. Baselines are not a challenge anymore. Baselines were always a challenge to generate baselines about the server, and log analytics solves this problem for us. It's a great reason to go to the cloud. Just the ability to have good baseline for our service is already a great reason to go to the cloud. It's a great method to learn what PaaS means. So the service will do most of the work. We'll just use the service to get the result we utilize. That's PaaS, platform as a service. Now let's talk about extended. How many of you really use extended events today? What can we talk about extended events? Fica Profiler doesn't work and is deprecated. So SQL Profiler is out of the question. SQL Trace doesn't work and is deprecated. Another one that is out of the question. Extended events requires a file type. Then many of you would say, oh, we can use extended events with Ring Buffer. Yes, you can use extended events with Ring Buffer, which has a limitation on the event size and will just cut any event that goes beyond this limitation. We will not know that event happened. So Ring Buffer is not trustworthy. And there are even some articles on the web talking about why you should never use Ring Buffer. Azure Storage requires authentication. So we need a storage. We can use Azure Storage for that, but Azure Storage requires authentication. What's the solution? We need to create a storage account. We need to have a storage account to store our extended events. We need to create a credential using the SAS key for the storage account. We need to create a credential in the data. Then we save the XEL file to the storage account and we can make queries over the storage account. Simple like that. Important. Hierarchical namespace is not supported yet. This feature, extended event, doesn't support hierarchical namespace enabled on the storage account. So you need to be sure that the storage account you use will not have hierarchical namespace enabled. When creating the credential name, we need to use the URL to the container as the credential name. You see this on the example. Remove the question mark from the SAS key. When we copy the SAS key, it comes with a question mark to be included in a URL. But on this case, we remove the question mark from the SAS key. Wildcards are not supported when querying the XEL files. When using SQL Server on-premise, we can use wildcards to query the XEL files, but on Azure SQL, wildcards are not supported. But there are other solutions for that. Let's see how this works. Let's see a demonstration about this working. Let's get back to the home of the portal, our resource group, and we can see I have a storage here already created for us. Marathon storage, it's already created. And I can check this storage with Azure Storage Explorer. It's a Windows application that I can download to analyze the storage I have on Azure. So I can see I have the storage Marathon with a blob container extended events and a folder called queries. Now, let's get back to our SSMS. Here we were using the custom examples. Now I use demo 1 to create our extended events example. I'm connected to AdventureWorks LT. I need to create a credential. This credential will be the responsible for the authentication between Azure SQL and the Azure Storage account. The credential needs to have the name of the container, which is the URL to the container. Why this? Because the feature that we are using with this credential, which is extended events, is not fully prepared to pass a credential. So in fact, what is happening behind the scenes is an interception. The call to the external storage is intercepted by the existence of a credential with the name of the storage, and the credential is used to access this external storage. That's what's happening. To create a credential, I need to create what's called a master key. Why? Why do I need to create a master key to create a credential? Simple, it's the method of encryption in SQL Server. The encryption is, in SQL Server is a hierarchical. So I start with a master key, and then the master key will encrypt out the rest below the master key. So I need to create a master key inside the database. It's created. And now I'll create the credential. I already ensured to get the correct SAS key from my Azure storage. So I'll create the credential, execute. And now I'll create the extended event session. There are some details here, very interesting, because these details are different from the on-premise environment. The credential is a database scoped credential. This is very interesting. Very interesting. Why? Because usually credentials are created on server level, not on database level. This is basically a new feature. The ability to create credentials in a database scope is a new feature. So we don't need to create an object on server level. We can create a credential on database level, database scope credential. And the extended event session. Usually the extended event session is also made on the server level, but not on Azure SQL. On Azure SQL, the extended event session is made on database level, not on server. This extended event session is very basic. I'm using very basic information and I'm capturing SQL starting statement. Basically the SQL starting statement and collecting some very basic information. SQL started and SQL completed. And I'm defining a target. The target is pointing to our blob storage, the folder queries where the files will be saved. So after creating the credential, I'll create the extended event session. It's created. The session can be saw here. I can open the database and there you see extended event sessions on a database level. And I can start this session. Alter event session on database state start. So I just started this session and captured the events on my environment. And I can make some queries like sales LT customers. I can even use the SQL query stress again. So, as in a magic trick, the query stress finished the execution. So, now I can read information from the extended event files. Let's take a look on the Storage Explorer. Make a refresh on this folder. And we see the file. For now, we have a single file. A single file that already has 1 GB in size. This file, due to all the activity, already has 1 GB in size. However, according the access to the database increase, more files will be created. So we need to be sure that we will read all the files and not a single file. So we use the function sysfnxe file target read file. This is not something new, to anyone already user to extend the defense. This is the user function that we use to read the files of the extended event. And I'm defining the path for the extended event. Mind that I don't use wildcards. I can't include star XEL, all the XEL file. No, it doesn't work like that. I need to specify the folder and leave to the function to read all the files in the folder. So I will select. Here I'm making a basic read of the data, and this basic read of the data is bringing me basic event data. When it happens, what event was captured, and the event details is on XML. So, yes, we need to translate this XML to understand the events. We really need to translate this XML to understand the events. So, we will need to play with XML queries. Yes, I know you don't like XML queries. I know XML queries are very complex, I know that. But I have written some blog posts on SimpleTalk that explains how you can simplify this work. You can simplify this work by creating functions that will read the content of the extended event file for you. So, let's see an example of the query. It's the basic query that we saw before on the core of the main query, but then we convert the column event data to XML, and you make a cross apply extracting nodes from this XML column. The column event data, we use the nodes method to extract nodes from this column, and then from the nodes we extract the specific values telling us what event happened. So let's execute this query, and now we can notice we have exactly the details of what was executed on our server. The statement executed, on which database it was executed, the name of the database, the username, and so on. We have all the details about what was executed on our environment, and we have these details in a way that we can query and analyze the data. So, only by this, it's already more powerful than SQL Profiler. But add to this that extended events has many hidden magic that I will not be talking now about this. I have some published videos about this, talking about the hidden magic of extended events, what you can capture using extended events. And you can capture many important information from the Azure SQL work. So, continuing on our slides. Manage identity and extended events. What is about extended events? What manage identity has in relation to extended events? The point is, when we use the extended event, we have to define a credential with an SAS key. It is quite safe, but we are spreading keys all around. This is not seen as the best security solution possible. A better way would be If our SQL Server could identify itself and tell to our storage, "It's me, it's SQL Server, and I would like to access you." And the storage would define if SQL Server can access the storage or not. To do that, we need Azure Active Directory in the middle, and we create an element called a managed identity for our Azure SQL. I'm giving an example of the Azure SQL accessing the Azure storage, but this is only an example. The idea of the managed identity works for most services inside Azure. These services receives a managed identity, and receiving a managed identity, they can receive access to all the Azure services, and they will authenticate to these other Azure services as themselves with the permission of the Azure Active Directory without any key exchange between the services. So we define a managed identity for SQL Server. We set permissions for the identity on the storage, and you change the credential for the managed identity. So we set the managed identity for the SQL, set the permissions on the storage, then the credential that is using SAS will be dropped, and we use a new credential that would say, "Please introduce yourself to the storage as yourself using your managed identity." To create the managed identity for our SQL Server, we need to use this PowerShell statement. We need to specify the resource group name and the server name, and ask to create the managed identity, assign an identity. In our example, the resource group name and the server name are the same, it's a coincidence. Then, having done this, we can set the permission for this account inside the Azure storage. We can go to role assignment on Azure storage and define the permission as storage blob data contributor. Let's see how this works. Let's make this work. I have this script prepared here. Demo 2 prepared here. I need to execute this script in PowerShell on Azure. To execute this script in Azure, I use a feature called Cloud Shell. It's here on the top menu. I can use the Cloud Shell. Let's open the Cloud Shell. Let's copy this script. The first script is intended to set the contents of my subscription, so the server will be correctly found. I have more than one subscription, that's why it's needed. Context set. Now I use the second statement. The second statement will define the managed identity for our SQL Server. But before really setting the second statement, executing the second statement, let's confirm one detail. Let's go to our Azure storage inside Cloud Marathon. So I have here the Azure storage inside Cloud Marathon, and I need to define the permission for that identity. How I do that? I use access control. In access control, I can set permissions for the storage. I use role assignments. It's very important to take care about the role assignment, to be very careful about this role assignments. Why? Why do we need to be so careful? Let's see an example. Let me add role assignment and I need to select a role. I have many roles here. The care that we need to have is to identify which roles are related to the service itself, to the storage account service, and which roles are related to the data that is inside the storage account. These are different roles. One user can be able to manage the service, the storage account, but cannot be allowed to see the data inside the storage account. These are different roles. For example, we have contributor here. But this contributor is related to the account. We have a storage account contributor as well, related to the account. The contributor is in a higher level than the account. Then we have a storage account contributor, but the storage account contributor is related to the service. I need to give permission to the data, so I need to choose storage blob data contributor. Blob data contributor. And now I need to choose the user. Choose the user. Our SQL server is called Cloud Marathon. It's not here. It's not here. That's what I was intended to show. It's not here. Then I'll get back to our Cloud Shell. I'll get this second statement to create the identity for our SQL Server. And I will execute this identity, this statement on Cloud Shell. It's done. It's executed. So now our SQL Server has an identity. Let's get back to our storage cloud. It's there. Now I have Cloud Marathon here. And I can choose Cloud Marathon and give permission to Cloud Marathon to access the data inside this blob storage, to write the data inside this blob storage. So I'm giving the permission directly to SQL Server. Save, and it's done. I don't need the Cloud Shell anymore. And let's get back to our SQL. So I was using script 2, now we use script 3. And the point is, the credential is still using the key, the SAS key. Let's drop this. I need to drop the extended event session and then drop the credential. Now I'll create a new credential and mind the difference. Is the difference, it only specifies with identity, manage identity. Only that, nothing else. Now I need to create the extended event session. Again, creating the extended event session. I can create this extended event session again, especially because the purpose is to leave the extended event session running. But in fact, I can just make the query. The file is still there. And the point is, the query will work even with the credential only pointing as manage identity. Because now SQL Server is authenticating to the blob storage using its own manage identity. So by doing this, we make our environment safer and we don't need to spread SAS keys all around. We use the manage identity of the server to connect to the storage account. On this session, we saw many techniques to monitor and manage an Azure SQL database, and techniques that usually we don't expect to be like this. Usually, we expect to be easy. It's not difficult, but it's different than the on-premise environment. These techniques are not the same as the on-premise environment. Here you have my contacts. Feel free to get in touch. It will be a pleasure to connect and keep in touch. Thank you very much for attending this session.